Today, we are going to talk about the organization of the Church of Jesus Christ, both in the Book of Mormon in Alma's day, as well as in our day by the prophet Joseph Smith. It's what is called in Scripture the Great Sign. As we have been moving through the four-day model, we have been overlaying the latter-day prophetic signs of the times with the chronology and history of the Book of Mormon, specifically Mormon's abridgment, with the idea that Mormon specifically laid out the Book of Mormon history to foretell our history, both past, present, and future, so that we could understand our day from the Lord's perspective and know how to prepare. As we are paralleling these signs, we saw at the beginning of the Book of Mormon prophets being persecuted, and that being a parallel with the Reformation and the Dark Ages and those martyrs during that time period. We saw the Lehites come to America and establish a covenant with God. In like manner, we saw righteous early colonists also come to America, establish covenants with God, and prosper. We will talk about those two groups founding nations of liberty in a future lesson, but we have talked about already the Jaredite record being translated, a record on gold plates, using the Urim and Thummim, and how this parallels with the Book of Mormon being translated in our day, also with the Urim and Thummim. We talked about Abinadi being martyred for his testimony, and Joseph Smith also being martyred for his own testimony. And now we see Alma organizing the Church of Jesus Christ in his day. We're going to talk about the organization of the church in our day. In the Joseph Smith translation of Revelation 12, verse 1, John the Revelator sees what he calls a great sign in heaven. He says that this great sign was a woman clothed with the sun, with the moon under her feet, and upon her head a crown of 12 stars. A few verses later, in verse 7, this woman is identified as the Church of God. In other words, this coming forth of the church is called a great sign in heaven. In Doctrine and Covenants section 88, verse 93, the Lord again refers to the coming forth of his church as a great sign in heaven. He says, "Immediately there shall appear a great sign in heaven, and all people shall see it together." The sign appears immediately after angels fly through heaven. And what have we seen in our own day? We have seen the Church of Jesus Christ restored to the earth after Moroni and other angels came to usher in this great sign. So if our proposed model is correct, Mormon intentionally put the signs of the times in the Book of Mormon. And if so, the church will be there. Well, we believe that Mormon carefully selected and highlighted the formation of the Church of Christ in the days of Alma and Mosiah to correspond with the establishment of the Church of Jesus Christ of Latter-day Saints in this dispensation. So let's begin looking through these parallels. Alma reestablishes the church among his people in a day when the priesthood had become corrupt. We're very familiar with this being true in our day, as Joseph Smith came forward in a time amidst corrupted churches and creeds. The keys and the priesthood had been taken from the earth. When Joseph Smith experienced his first vision and he spoke with God the Father and Jesus Christ, he recorded in his history, quote, "I was answered that I must join none of the churches, for they were all wrong. And the personage who addressed me said that all their creeds were an abomination in his sight, that those professors were all corrupt, that they draw near to me with their lips, but their hearts are far from me. They teach for doctrines the commandments of men, having a form of godliness, but they deny the power thereof," end quote. Alma saw this corruption firsthand in his own day as well. And seeing that corruption and coming to a knowledge that this was wrong is really the same journey that Joseph Smith went on. There is another account of the first vision that Joseph Smith gave in around 1832, where Joseph Smith provided some more details about what led him into the sacred grove. Joseph Smith was looking around him in his day, and he saw that so many of the men and women who were professing Christians, those who professed to believe in the Bible, either believed in teachings that were not found in the Bible or were themselves living corrupt lives. And at 12 years old, this began confusing Joseph Smith, and he began searching for the truth. And he points out in this account, "At about the age of 12 years, my mind became seriously impressed with regard to the all-important concerns for the welfare of my immortal soul, which led me to searching the scriptures, believing, as I was taught, that they contained the word of God, and thus applying myself to them, and my intimate acquaintance with those of different denominations led me to marvel exceedingly, for I discovered that they did not adorn their profession by a holy walk and godly conversation agreeable to what I found contained in that sacred depository." Notice that Joseph Smith is reading the Bible and he's understanding this is what a godly life looks like. This is what good character looks like. And he is not seeing that around him. "This was a grief to my soul. Thus, from the age of 12 years to 15, I pondered many things in my heart concerning the situation of the world, of mankind, the contentions and divisions, the wickedness and abominations, and the darkness which pervaded the minds of mankind. My mind became exceedingly distressed, for I became convicted of my sins. And by searching the scriptures, I found that mankind did not come unto the Lord, but that they had apostatized from the true and living faith, and there was no society or denomination that built upon the gospel of Jesus Christ, as recorded in the New Testament. And I felt to mourn for my own sins and for the sins of the world." End quote. Alma came to recognize the sins of the people and the church around him by listening to the words of Abinadi and being turned back to the scriptures. Joseph Smith, in like manner, began studying the scriptures at a very young age, and from the scriptures began to understand, wait a minute, all of this behavior, these beliefs that are around me, are not in harmony with God's will. And Joseph Smith, being the very pure, honest, and incredible man that he was, that led him as a very, very young boy to begin mourning for those sins and seeking after God and seeking for something better. That something better came, and in both the case of Alma and for Joseph Smith, the church was born. In Alma's day, Mormon specifically itemizes what some of these wicked sins and corruptions were. He lists many wives, concubines, and whoredoms. He speaks of all of the good priests being replaced with corrupt priests. He speaks of the people being burdened with taxes and having to labor to support iniquity, supporting these priests in their laziness. He speaks of elegant and spacious buildings being built up to glorify supposedly the church, but not really God. We can see so many of these parallels with the early apostasy of the church, with the Dark Ages. These were the same concerns that men like Martin Luther and William Tyndale and John Wycliffe and others had as they looked at the state of Christianity around them.
We are back from Rome almost 2 weeks. 2 weeks and scarcely a word, even in the confessional. As your father in Christ, I order you to speak.
Rome is a circus, a running sewer. You can buy anything, sex, salvation. They have brothels just for clerics.
As they probably do in Leipzig.
One church had the coins for which Judas sold our Lord. 100 years off purgatory for kissing each one.
And you think Rome unique in such relics?
There are even rumors about the Holy Father himself, that he has a lust for power.
Let's go outside.
What's wrong with here?
Well, this floor, the color. I like color, but you give your brothers a hard choice. They either learn to scrub like you or find a way to make your patch a little less sparkling.
So many of those concerns continued to Joseph Smith's day. Now, in earlier lessons, we've talked about the founding of America, which was a righteous Christian foundation. We've talked about the Pilgrims and the Puritans and the Huguenots and the Scottish Covenanters and Quakers and others who were righteous men and women who were coming to America to establish a civilization based in the morals and the gospel of Jesus Christ. So then how do we get to Joseph Smith's day, where we really see developing corruption? Well, while the early colonists did not have the fullness of the gospel, they didn't have the keys and authority and the priesthood, they did live according to the light and the knowledge that they had, and they were good people. Nephi describes them as humble followers of Christ. But between the colonization of America and the birth of Joseph Smith, there was a decline in some generations of those people. We can actually see this shift occurring just shortly from the Revolutionary War to Joseph Smith's day. A perfect example is the very famous man, Ralph Waldo Emerson. A lot of people are not aware that his grandfather was actually a pastor, a Revolutionary War patriot, who believed very strongly in the gospel of Jesus Christ, a gospel that his grandson moved away and rejected. I'm going to play a short clip here that was a promotional piece done by the Western Conservatory of the Arts and Sciences, Jeff Botkin and his family, for a documentary called Homeschool Dropouts, which is on a different topic. It's a very good and insightful documentary about the decline and sometimes the rejection of succeeding generations from what their fathers and mothers sacrificed and bled for. But in illustrating their point, they share some fascinating history about the Revolutionary War and the Emerson family, which helps us better understand the decline that occurred both in the Book of Mormon and in our day is a parallel.
I'm standing on Concord Bridge in Massachusetts. This is where the War for American Independence began, the war that George III called a Presbyterian Parson's Rebellion. Behind me, over the bridge, came the British Redcoats, and they met the American militia, a militia that had been encouraged by pastors all over the colonies to resist unbiblical tyranny. And one of the men that was encouraging them that day was Reverend William Emerson Sr., and he lived in the old manse just behind me here. His involvement in this battle is small but important, and his involvement in the war and New England history is very telling. William Emerson served as the chaplain of the Massachusetts Provincial Legislature, and he went on to enlist in the Continental Army, where he also served as a chaplain. In many ways, his involvement in the war is typical of American pastors of this time in history. But what's really interesting is the way that his family legacy was honored by those that came after him, particularly his grandson, Ralph Waldo Emerson, who wrote the famous poem about this battle here on Concord Bridge, part of which is on the Minuteman Monument down here. Ralph Waldo Emerson was very quick to celebrate the bid for liberty made by the Minutemen here at Concord, but in many ways, his personal worldview and theology could not be more different from his grandfather's. William Emerson stood here and encouraged the men with him to fear God more than the enemy, to trust in God, and to know that their cause was just because the law of God binds both common man and kings. Ralph Waldo Emerson is the father of transcendentalism. So he rejects the idea of God's sovereignty, God's existence, or the idea that there can be any moral law outside of a rational man's feelings and experiences. How could this family have changed so much over just three generations? Ralph Waldo Emerson wants very much to appreciate all of the things that his grandparents fought for, but in doing so, he must reject all the things that they stood for. The Botkin siblings wanted to know how it was that Christian children can drift away from, forget, and then eventually oppose the legacies that their families have struggled to build. We made a documentary called Homeschool Dropouts, And in our research, we discovered that modern American Christians may have a lot to learn from the Emerson family, and that we need to be taking a stand for the faith and freedom that our parents have fought for.
In the Book of Mormon, we see this with Zeniff. Zeniff was a good king who fought for freedom in godly warfare, and yet his son rejects that foundation and undoes all of the good that his father fought for. This was occurring in Joseph Smith's day. Now, this was not everyone, but it was definitely some. In the previous lesson, when we talked about the martyrdom of Joseph Smith, we talked about Hurlbut and how Hurlbut fought against Joseph Smith and was trying to gather all these slanders and libelous tales. And in the midst of that, his wife was caught having an affair with one of the leading members of the Mentor Baptists. This was more common than we might want to realize in early 19th century America, and of course, throughout the 19th century. Just because someone claimed to be a Christian did not mean they lived as a Christian. There were good Christians, there were hypocrites. There were good people in America, there were bad people in America. Helen Mar Kimball pointed this out in one of her pamphlets when she was defending the doctrine and practice of celestial plural marriage. And she pointed out how ironic it was that the chief enemies and detractors of the saints, the ones who cried, "Sinner, sinner, this polygamy and plural marriage is so evil," she said, "Physician, heal yourself. Look at your culture. Most of you are all engaged in what is even worse, immorality, adultery with serious consequences." This is what she said. The husband of one of her friends, quote, had been for many years the proprietor of a large hotel in one of the western cities, which had been her home from the time they were married. She related instances where married and unmarried ladies of wealth and influence came there closely veiled to meet clandestinely with men who were fathers and husbands. And this illegal and revolting practice, she said, was carried on day and night among different classes. And what was worse, they were mostly churchgoers and very distinguished patterns of propriety who desired so much to convert and bring the Mormons up to their own level. Oftentimes, those women, she said, were accompanied by their daughters, and even little children came with their mothers for a blind. And in this way, we're being led into the same path of vice by coming in contact with it. Being a mother herself and seeing the dangers that beset her own children, they had long since moved into a separate house. Reverend T. DeWitt Talmadge of Brooklyn said, "I could call the names of many of the frequenters of these haunts of sin, judges of courts, distinguished lawyers, officers in churches, political orators that talk on the Republican, Democratic and greenback platforms about God and good morals, until you might almost take them for evangelists, expecting 1,000 converts in one night. I have something to tell you more astonishing than that the houses of iniquity are supported by wealthy people, when I tell you they are supported by the heads of families, fathers and husbands, with the awful perjury upon them of broken marriage vows. And while many of them keep their families on niggardly portions, with hardly enough to sustain life, have spent their thousands for the diamonds and wardrobe and equipage of iniquity." End quote. There is a reason that Mormon was very specific and intentional in describing what were the problems with King Noah, with his priests, and his people when Abinadi was martyred, and when Alma left them to form the Church of Jesus Christ. He's trying to explain to us and show why did the people in Joseph Smith's day, why did the United States of America as a whole in general reject Joseph Smith and the saints? Why did they drive the saints from their borders? What was the problem? What led them to not being able to see the light and truth? We're going to talk later in this lesson about the Civil War and the consequences of that rejection and that sin. But for now, let's just talk for a moment about Alma founding the church. These not only parallel Alma founding the church and Joseph Smith founding the church, but if we actually study Alma's founding, Mormon is very careful to include specific points that help us understand what is the most important about the restoration of the church. What were the important principles that we need to recognize and preserve in our day? We cannot review all of the points, but here's just a few. In Mosiah 18:19, Alma points out that he commanded the teachers that they would teach nothing save it were the things which he had taught and which had been spoken by the mouth of the holy prophets, end quote. Alma established a standard. These are the standard works. This is where you look to for doctrine. Just teach these words. In Doctrine Covenants 52:9, similar instruction was given to the missionaries. Let them journey from thence, preaching the word by the way, saying none other things than that which the prophets and apostles have written, and that which is taught them by the Comforter through the prayer of faith. In the Book of Mormon, Alma ordains priests. In Mosiah 18:18, authority is repeatedly emphasized, the concept of ordaining these priests and authority. Mormon wants to point that out. Of course, that was a very important theme of Joseph Smith's restoration, the restoration of authority and the restoration of priesthood. In Mosiah 18:17, they are called the Church of Christ. Their church is named after Jesus Christ, just like in our day. Alma also commands his teachers that they should preach nothing, he says. This is in Mosiah 18:20, save it were repentance and faith on the Lord who had redeemed his people. Jesus Christ gave the same instructions to missionaries in our day in Doctrine and Covenants section 11:9, when he said, say nothing but repentance unto this generation. Keep my commandments and assist to bring forth my work according to my commandments, and you shall be blessed. Alma commands his people and teaches them to observe the Sabbath. The Sabbath and keeping the Sabbath day holy is a very important point that has been emphasized by so many presidents of the church and was an important teaching in the days of Joseph Smith. Alma sets aside one day to worship and assemble with his people. This is in Mosiah 18, verse 25. He teaches that the church leadership should be just and righteous. That's in Mosiah 23:17, that there should be no contention. This is in Mosiah 18, verse 21. The priests are taught not to be dependent. There is not a paid clergy. He commands them, quote, that the priests whom he had ordained should labor with their own hands for their support, end quote. This is in Mosiah 18:24. Later, this is emphasized again in Mosiah 27, verse 4 through 5, where the priests are taught to labor for their own support. This is a very important principle and teaching, and the reason is that when an individual becomes paid and gains a salary for their teaching, pride is introduced in. Too often it leads to priestcraft and other issues. So having a clergy and priests that are teaching, that are rewarded, Alma says, by the grace of God, by God giving them spiritual gifts and blessings, this helps prevent pride. It helps ensure that there is no one becoming experts, that all are equals and working together for the good of building the kingdom of God. Alma also commanded his people, this is in Mosiah 18:27, that the people of the church should impart of their substance, everyone according to that which he had. If he have more abundantly, he should impart more abundantly. And of him that had but little should be required. And to him that had not should be given. And thus they should impart of their substance of their own free will. This is important. Essentially, what we're seeing here is that Alma was instituting what Joseph Smith tried to restore, basically a form of the United Order and the law of consecration. Alma was trying to do the same, and Mormon actually specifically points this out. That means that that aspect of the restoration was not only important, it was critical. It's being repeated and emphasized by Mormon here. But Mormon points out something very critical about this consecration and United Order that Alma institutes, and that is that everyone imparted their substance of their own free will and good desires towards God and to those priests that stood in need, yea, and to every needy, naked soul, end quote. Now, why would Mormon feel the need to insert this? Again, remember, he has limited space, limited room. He's choosing every point very carefully. Why do you think this would be important? Well, I think it's very easy to see in our day because Joseph Smith and the church has repeatedly been misrepresented, or the practice of Joseph Smith instituting the United Order or the law of consecration has been twisted and inverted too often to be allegedly supporting a form of communism. People have said communism is essentially just the United Order. They're one and the same. It's socialist. Socialism is part of the gospel. And nothing could be further from the truth. Marion G. Romney has an excellent talk called Socialism and the United Order. I highly recommend reading that. It's a conversation for another time, but I believe Mormon is specifically trying to point out a few of the principles that are stark differences between the United Order and consecration and Satan's counterfeit, which is communism and socialism. And one of those principles is the principle of stewardship, agency, people investing their substance of their own free will, and it's all motivated by God instead of the government. Just a few other parallels. If you go through any of these parallels, you could talk for hours about all of the comparisons with Joseph Smith. So I'm just trying to point out a couple things that Mormon brings out in the Book of Mormon. And you can see these are important, how they parallel with the church in our day, and why they need to be remembered. But in Alma's day, Alma founds the church amidst persecution, people trying to kill him and his people. And of course, that is the story of Joseph Smith and the early pioneers, the saints being driven from Kirtland, driven from Missouri, driven from Nauvoo. The king accuses Alma of stirring up rebellion. That's how they justify this persecution and this driving. King Noah says, Alma's stirring up rebellion against the government, and we got to send an army to destroy him. And if you look at Joseph Smith and the early pioneers, often it was the same accusation, and it was military government forces often that were involved in driving and persecuting the saints. In Missouri, there were military forces that were brought together to help with the driving and the persecution. It was the governor of Missouri, Lilburn Boggs, who filed the extermination order. In Nauvoo, it was the Carthage Greys, again, a military force that assassinated Joseph Smith. There were state troops involved in the drivings and the later persecutions. In Utah, we're going to talk about the Utah War, but there was literally a military army sent from the United States of America to Salt Lake to annihilate and wipe out Deseret here in the Rocky Mountains. So very similar in Alma's day, he was facing the same persecution and the same threats, and the Lord had to protect Alma and his people from bondage. Later, they were captured by the Lamanites, they were miraculously delivered, and that is an amazing parallel we're going to talk about here with the Utah War and miraculous deliverances of our pioneer forefathers and foremothers. Meanwhile, at the same time, King Noah's people were also captured by the Lamanites, and the story of their deliverance is a little different than the story of Alma's people and their deliverance. In King Noah's case, they had to go through some very sore repenting and chastisement from the Lord before they were delivered. And how both groups escape is fascinating, and that is what we're going to talk about next.